Hi, it's Dr. Catherine D. Harris for English 10, Great Works of Literature, Techno-Literature, Introduction to Frankenstein in this mini-lecture. In the last lecture, I gave you the Gothic romance and the background to that from the 18th century, but now I want to speak specifically to Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. This is the first text in our semester. She wrote this text in 1816, published it in 1818 anonymously, and then revised it significantly in 1831 according to criticism. In the 1831, she removes the relationship between Victor Frankenstein and his cousin Elizabeth because people were crying that it was too incestuous. But then that takes out a whole dynamic. So, quite frankly, most critics and myself really believe that the 1818 version is the superior version. Now, the Gothic novel came to prominence in the 18th century, but we're reading into the 19th century in England. And conventions of the Gothic novel found in Frankenstein very specifically are dementia, obsession, melodrama, incest, inflated rhetoric, a morbid passion, dreams that seem real, an accent on the supernatural, the grotesque, the marvelous, the terrible. There's a woman in jeopardy. There's a fascination with the pseudosciences. There's a heated chase, and there's a villain hero. And we talked about the Byronic hero in the last mini lecture. Things to consider in terms of themes relating to the history of the 19th century and Shelley's Frankenstein: gender, gender norms and gender roles, science, religion, philanthropy, glorification of the child. Because let's think about it. Isn't the creature one ginormous child? Sense of damnation, sacrificial victims. If you've done your entire reading assignment, you'll see that there's a few murders that have happened. Extremes, characterization of men, women, and madness, guided by benevolence. Victor Frankenstein really meant to do good. Now, what I didn't ask you guys to read was the 1831 introduction to Frankenstein. That's the second edition that Mary Shelley published. She wanted to answer a lot of people's requests for how it was created, the entire novel itself. At first in 1818 when she published it, she did it anonymously, and then she was soon outed and people discovered that it was her. But prior to that, critics had said, this novel is so good, it must have been written by a man. And they said that because typically men were educated at college and university more so than women were. There were no universities for women. They just had to learn on their own. So Mary Shelley is basically self-taught. And she also brings into the novel itself the philosophies of her mother, Mary Wollstonecraft, who wrote The Vindication of the Rights of Woman and The Vindication of the Rights of Man. And she did this in 1790 and 1791. Now, Mary Wollstonecraft really believed that everybody had a right to education, young girls and young boys, and it should be an equal education. Typically, young girls were educated in the fine arts, painting, languages, translations. They were not necessarily taught how to write poetry or what classical literature was. Most girls educated in that vein were affluent or they had their own tutor. School was not compulsory at this time. You didn't have middle school or high school or junior high. You just had to study. You just had to know. They didn't have as many distractions as we do either. So what they had to do was sit down and read the newspaper or magazine or a book to each other and then go to salons and discuss it. So Mary Wollstonecraft died on the birth of Mary Shelley. So her father named her Mary, and she's typically called Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley. This means that Mary Shelley grew up without a father, without a mother. She had a father, and he was highly philosophical. And then she marries this guy named Percy, and he's very well known, but he's going to die young in his 1820s. So Mary is really left alone to fend for her entire family as a successful novelist. So in 1831, with that second edition and the revised edition of Frankenstein, she decides to tell the story. What particularly happened was that they got together, she and her friends in Italy, and they decided that they would one night in a castle write down their worst horror stories and nightmares. And Mary Shelley wrote that she had a dream that became her short story. And the dream was these two yellow eyes floating out at her while she was lying in bed. And they were asking her for something, but she didn't know what. And she woke up in a panic, screaming. And there you have the beginning of Frankenstein. And this is a dream that comes back to Victor after he's created the creature and he's fallen ill. He sees these two yellow eyes coming at him out of nowhere, and it terrifies him and it horrifies him. Now, the 1831 introduction talks about writing from chaos, not creation, meaning that what Mary Shelley really wanted to do was write from everything that she knew around her and organize it. And that's an interesting view of literary creation. Most of you came to this conclusion that literature was an escape and that it represented emotions and passions. It's quite different from what they expected of the novel and writing and literature in the 18th and 19th century. So we've evolved a lot. The narrative structure of Frankenstein is that it's embedded letters by Victor Frankenstein being composed orally and given to Robert Walton. Victor stops the story occasionally to speak to Robert Walton. He uses foreshadowing because it's not told in the first person. This means that it's a retrospective narrative. Victor is remembering, he's telling Robert Walton, who writes it down, and sends it to his sister, Mrs. Saville, in letters and in a journal form. So this is very much removed from what we would consider the truth or the original, and so we have a lot to question in Volume 1 and Volume 2. Robert Walton is stuck on a ship when his crew doesn't really like him. He says he's a failed poet, and he's very lonely. And he's exploring the North Pole, and they're breaking their way through the ice, and they get stuck. And the men are about to mutiny, and then suddenly Robert Walton sees something across the ice that's huge and monstrous. And then Victor Frankenstein shows up, and Robert Walton celebrates. He's finally got a friend. He's got somebody to take care of. He's got somebody who's almost like him. So that starts the tale of Victor Frankenstein at the very end of his woeful life, and not at the very beginning of this story. So we start in the middle, almost. This is not a first-person account. It's letters and journals amassed and published by Robert Walton's sister in the end. It creates an unreliable narrator. We can't trust who's telling what, and we have no idea. Think about Robert Walton stuck in ice. He's probably going a little stir crazy. Think about Victor Frankenstein and all the travels and travails he's been through. Is he really the wellest man to be able to tell this story? By the way, do you guys remember I told you at the beginning of the class, the power held in a narrative is the person who's controlling the entire thing. The first one who speaks and the last one who speaks. So we know who the first one was in this novel. It was Robert Walton. He speaks, he has a voice. But who's the last one? We have a double setting. It's an isolated ship in an ice field in the middle of exploration. And we also have Geneva, which is the seat of old philosophy and learning. Volume 1 and 2 set up the relationship between Victor Frankenstein and his creature, his creation. And Christianity is questioned. The sins of the father are visited on the son. Also, education is questioned as well. Mary Wollstonecraft believed in this idea of tabula rasa. You were born a blank slate, and then throughout your life, through a good education, you learn the difference between good and evil, and you make that selection yourself. I have to ask the question so far. As the creature born tabula rasa? And what about Victor? Does he know the difference between good and evil? Is he resorting to his technology and his sciences and his education as a benevolent form of philanthropy to do better? Or is he satiating his own desire to be a great name? So the Gothic setting that's really apparent in Frankenstein is foreign land. The hero is looking for himself. It's set in the past. The exploration of an unknown and wild area, supernatural elements, tragic events, mystery, irreversible fate of the hero who's mad for knowledge and power, and there's ghosts and devils. And that concludes our introduction to Frankenstein.